So I'd like to start with three shortish epigraphs. So three shortish epigraphs. The first one is from a short essay by Fernand Braudel, Les Espagnols et l'Afrique du Nord, from a 1928 issue of Revue Africaine. He writes, dans le Far West méditerranéen, les côtes d'Espagne et d'Afrique se rapprochent au point que d'une rive, on distingue les feux allumés sur l'autre rive. La Méditerranée occidentale n'est plus qu'un bras de mer, une manche, un channel facile à traverser et qui ne peut jouer le rôle d'obstacle. Much later, in 1980, in one of his first books, Emmanuel Bocard composes, d'ici Tarifa, pourtant, on distingue, paraît-il, jusqu'au promeneur de l'avenue Pasteur à Tanger. And finally, in a book-length interview with Hervé Sanson, the Algerian anthropologist and poet Habib Senghor declaims, aujourd'hui, la Méditerranée ne joue aucun rôle. La frontière entre le nord et le sud reste étanche. In 1990, Emmanuel Ocar publishes Les Élégies, a suite of seven unnumbered, untitled elegies whose intertextual and historical references include Spurius Malleus, Aurelia, Orestilia, Plotinus, Strabo, Theocritus, Ptolemy, Ovid, and Lysias. Ocar first collected some of these elegies in previous publications, Elegie 1 through Elegie 4 were first interlayered in a collection from 1979, and Elegie 5 appeared in Un privé à Tanger, a detective from Tangiers, the first of Ocar's two main collections of critical writings. Now, the focal point concentrated in the Strait of Gibraltar forms a crucial nexus in Ocar's writing of the world, which is constricted to the Mediterranean world, the micro-world or microcosm of the world that Ocar would seem to always carry around in his pocket, you know, scribbled down on a piece of paper that's sort of folded and folded and folded over and over again. He was born in Cannes, raised in Tangiers. He first develops a vision of the Mediterranean poetics at length in a collection from 1978, but expands it in the one from 1980, which I'll be reading with you today, called Une journée dans le Détroit, A Day in the Strait, which he subtitles Récit, Story, Narrative. And counter to me talking about the world, I'm actually going to bring us back to the poem, we continued last year's discussions. So I'm going to do two things today. I'll focus on the Strait as a figure of originesis, or orogeny, in this work, A Day in the Strait, punctuated by a brief analysis, second discrete analysis, of one grammatical and typographical aspect of Ocar's elegies. I show how the Strait in the Sea becomes a seam in the poem. The Strait's and the poem's modular mobility establish a divergent mode of Mediterranean lyric that may at first appear anti-lyric in its resolute opposition to writing the world, to writing the subject, and to engaging lyric's figurative framework of enunciation. For Ocar does not read as a lyric right off the bat, right off the page, though his writing remains embroiled with what Glenn Fetzer calls the challenge of lyricism. A closer look at Ocar reveals him to only be too engaged with lyric, only too conscious of the enunciating subject's disappearance in and from the world. So my talk is in two parts, one long part, and one short one in lieu of a conclusion. Quelque chose comme l'intérieur d'une brique, writes Ocar in a 1987 text. No one, he insists, can really tell you that the inside of a brick is red. Ocar's textual metonymic representations of the Mediterranean unveil interior contradictory mobilities. They raise to the surface of the poem temporalities that are slow, profound, geological, poetic, letters or the interiors of a poem, orogeny or millenary time deeper than the sea. Ocar's poem insists on the difficulty of seeing, watching, the difficulty of waiting for the apparition of that which is seen, watched, the difficulty of writing, of naming a period or a process as invisible, as imperceptible to the human eye, to the human measure of life as orogeny, which is the process of folding and faulting of the earth's crust, the dislocations of its outer shell, the formation or deformation that is a mountain like the Rock of Gibraltar in the middle of the strait. The Rock of Gibraltar has no interiority or interiority, so how can the poem say this? It, the poem, Ocar, he, Ocar, show us, c'eût été quelque chose comme, what would have been something like the Mediterranean, something like the inside of the Mediterranean, something like the contents and discontents of the Millenary Sea. Apophatic. Nowhere in his writing does Oka actually ever write Mediterranean. He only ever writes things like the Mediterranean, things close to the Mediterranean, adjacent to it, to the side, turned elsewhere, things on it. Oka contemplates the Mediterranean in Une Journée dans le Détroit. Two episodes in particular show us the way to Oka's way, the path he follows, his walk toward a view of the Mediterranean. These two episodes, that I will read with you momentarily, appear alongside another thread of this poem, of this story, if we can call a poem a story, and I will, this other thread, which is etymological. Le dictionnaire étymologique de la langue française de Bloch et Warburg place Détroit entre détritus, usé par frottement, et détruire, to destroy. Le mot lui-même, avant de dessiner une langue d'eau qui fait communiquer deux mers ou qui sépare deux terres, évoque l'idée de resserrement, de détresse, d'angoisse. Toutefois, je ne parviens pas à faire coïncider l'image plaisante que je conservais du Détroit avec cette figure d'étranglement à laquelle le vous son origine, which I translate rather clumsily as this choking figure. Étranglement is like choking, it's throttling, it's strangling, it's tightening, constriction, it's a bottleneck, it's a throttle valve. S'étrangler is also to make yourself hoarse, as I am, kind of getting over a plain cold, to lose your voice. In Émile Littré's 19th century dictionary, Détroit is indeed preceded by detritus, but followed by four other terms in three different forms, adjectival, substantive, and verbal. We have détrompement, which is to be mistaken, to debunk, détroncation, which is a violent term for a surgical term for an abortion procedure, détrônement, to dethrone, and détroussement, to rob, to fleece, before finally leading us to détruire. Oka'r lodges the anguish of a difficult separation from the world into the words of his poem. Inasmuch as straight, the Mediterranean suffers, a choking figure it makes suffer. So here are the two episodes that I want to read with you. To the strait's etymological story, we're now going to add a complementary figure, orogeny. Here the strait is far from associated with any pleasant image of the sea, and these two episodes become two poles that hold in place the textual dynamics of separation and unification achieved by the etymological orogenic strait, which folds and refolds the Mediterranean and the earth. And so Oka's unaspirated aspiration for Tangiers and the Strait of Gibraltar in their extreme geographical occidentality, the Brodel's West Mediterranean Far West, his desire for it to signify, to represent the Mediterranean. Je sentais qu'à l'évidence, et comme à mon insu, la figure du détroit commençait à agir conformément à son étymologie, que la ressemblance des bords, bien que celui d'en face restât invisible, ferait progressivement se refermer sur toute chose les taux de la double fracture étymologique, the vice of the double orogenic fracture. Pour l'instant, je regardais le sable que les rafales de vent soulevaient sur la plage. Couple of pages later. L'espace, comme le temps, allait en se rétrécissant au point que je sentais venir le moment où il se dresserait comme une immense vitre au milieu du détroit, où le détroit lui-même ne serait plus qu'une surface verticale, transparente et vide, qui sépare sans rien refléter. How does a timeless, ageless, distressing strait start acting like a word in a poem, like a word in a dictionary? The poet in the story, Emmanuel, confuses one Mediterranean shore or coastal edge for another. La ressemblance des bords, he says. The resemblance of the edges, he said. The strait's distinctive trait neither bifurcates nor conjoins its coasts and edges, but rather it's an immense concentration that separates and fragments, the tightening of a vice, of a slipknot, l'étau de la double fracture orogénique, an immense concentration that shatters. Elsewhere, Oka'r leads the reader to the realization that objet et obstacle sont deux mots très voisins. La notion d'objet ne serait-elle pas un obstacle? As the Mediterranean object or obstacle. In Oka'r's poem, the day spent in the strait has, the day spent in the Strait has for its object or target the sea. The sea, the Mediterranean, easily traversed, easy to see, easy to pierce with a gaze all the way to the other side of the waters. For the poem, is the Mediterranean the object or the obstacle of the reversals of the visual and textual relations that Occam entertains with the sea and strait? Anchored in the middle of the Strait of Gibraltar, Emmanuel and his companions can see either side. But what about the strait itself? Do they see the strait? And what does the strait see? Is it seen? Can it be seen from the middle, from the center, from the navel, from the inside out? Now let us follow Occam's logic to its end. The strait as observer, spectator, might seem to be defined by this double fracture, though this double fracture, la ressemblance des bords, cannot exist because it is separated by the strait. Which of the two objects is seen by the other? Are the moving waters of the strait reflected in the image of the mountains formed by orogenesis? Or are the mountains in their quietude, their tranquility, their imperceptible orogeny, reflected uniquely among themselves on either shore? In Elizabeth Bishop's words, does the land lean down to lift the sea from under? Is the land tugging at the sea from under? The sea, Occam suggests, disappears in the middle of the strait. From the middle of the strait all the way to neighboring coasts and littorals, where does the sea end? Where does land begin? Which, in Maurice Blanchot's formulation, is créateur, le premier? Which one is the creator? Which one comes first? All points of reference here disappear in an endless game of perspectival reflection and refraction, going as far as stopping all reflection. Emmanuel possesses just a few visual shards as anchoring points when he's in the middle of the sea. He remains alone and left alone. He is like inside the Mediterranean. The sea and the strait will yet swallow him whole. Emmanuel thus undertakes the temerary passage of a formidable strait, temperamental climate, perturbing perspectives. In the concentrated middle of the noose of the noose of the double orogenic fracture, he drifts as if lost at sea. Nous errions depuis longtemps sur l'eau à la recherche de repères introuvables dans le paysage mobile de la côte. Time and space, too, begin to behave weirdly, as if they were straits, se rétrécissant au point que je sentais venir le moment où il, l'espace, se dresserait comme une immense vitre au milieu du détroit. In their spatial and visual mobility, to the eyes, to the letters of Occam's poems, the straits assumes an axis inverse to its habitual cartographic, geographic perspective of horizontal flatness. Le détroit lui-même ne serait plus qu'une surface verticale, transparente et vide, qui sépare sans rien refléter. The Cocardian vision defines and reduces Mediterranean space around Tangiers and Gibraltar to simultaneous minimalizing bifurcation and conjunctions. The space alternates between two axes, between vertical depth and horizontal stretch, between la profondeur de l'eau, the depth of the water, and le paysage qui s'allongeait à l'horizon, the landscape laid out to the horizon. Occam reproduces in the heart of the strait the four cardinal points along the dual, divisive, and uniting axes of the Mediterranean and the Atlantic, and the two sides, and the Atlantic on two sides, and the North African and the coastlines of Southern Europe on the other two. So the strait is kind of like a square folded inside out. And so in the squaring of its double duality, the Strait of Gibraltar underscores the four points of interference between them. To be in the middle of the strait is to amount to occupying the very site where all directional criteria in the world just disappears, it dissolves. On land, Emmanuel could have seen Tarifa from Tangiers, Tangiers from Tarifa, yet at sea he finds himself in the very middle of the strait. Cities assail him from all sides. They are mobile, they are all the same. The strait, imperceptible, or impenetrable rather, no longer reflects anything. Emmanuel dwells in the heart of a privileged site, in the middle of the strait, in the very center of direction. There, the final points of orientation fall apart, then efface themselves. What distinguishes front from back, left from right, here from there, me from you? So the sea and the world of the sea are placed in a parenthetical vise, right? You can think of that square that turned inside out. The sea, the strait, is held in place by this thing that constricts. It contains as it excludes, it chokes as it mollycoddles, it highlights and downplays, it reveals, it effaces. And so the Kaf makes extensive usage of a typographical mode of enunciation, the parenthetical, in order to actively disappear the lyric subject, être, French, being, from the world. The first time that Okar makes use of this, at least in my reading of Okar, of all of his work, the first time he makes use of this parenthetical mode occurs at the end of Elegie II. À présent, nous voici au cœur de l'hiver, un lieu doublement enfoncé, effacé de l'histoire. Henceforth, parenthetical effacements haunt Okar's elegies. Le jardin, un jardin d'hiver. Le jardin est un jardin d'hiver. Ses eaux de jade, ses eaux étaient de jade. Aucune fleur n'est colorée, aucune fleur colorée. Which is impossible to translate into English. La Saint-Jean sera le signal, la Saint-Jean le signal. Okar's elegies draw visual attention to the superfluity of the verb être. To be is the weakest verb in our languages, and this was something that was beaten out of me by my dissertation advisor, Richard Siever. You do not have the right to use the verb être. This is recorded, so I hope you read them that. But in a language such as Arabic, that ghosts much of the poetic composition that attracts me, the present tense of the verb to be is never used. It's even frequently grammatically impossible to parse within a line. It's al-ra'ib, it's l'absent, it's the absent. I think Okar would agree. Here he writes in La Notion d'Objet about his grammar lessons as a child in Tangier. La grammaire du lycée Renaud distinguait trois ordres de verbes. Le verbe d'état, dormir. Le verbe de changement d'état, maigrir. Et le verbe d'action, enfoncer. Quant à être, qui est habituellement rangé parmi les verbes d'état, il n'appartient, me semble-t-il, à aucun des trois ordres. Il est même discutable que ce soit un verbe. Il est le cœur de la tautologie avant le sens. This brings us to Okar's most extreme stretching of the effacement of existence. The finest example in my reading of how his parenthetical poetics expands but only to enclose, efface, and subsume an entire semantic unit. In Elegy 4, for instance. There's so many possible ways to read this. You can read it by column, you can read it vertically, you can read it from bottom to up, top to bottom. And this does look on the page as something that's totally inscribed in the tradition of Le Grand Rhetoriqueur. It could be maintenant, rien, rien, maintenant, les feuilles, sombre, et, ou à peine, d'autres, souvenirs, le souvenir. Maintenant, les feuilles, sombre, rien, ou à peine, le souvenir, d'autres souvenirs. So just to close, I'm going to say that here and now, in this poem, something and nothing new and untranslatable are happening in the poem. In the broken lines, the first line, maintenant les feuilles sombres, es is the second person indicative singular of the verb être, doubles as a plural grammatical ending to sombre. So here it's like now, the dark leaves. But sombre, which is possibly my favorite verb in French, means so much more. It means to render deaf, to render grave or serious, veiled, to be plunged in water, sombrer, to plunge, to go deep into, to allow oneself to be invaded by something. It also means to die, to disappear. It's to fall apart, to péricliter, se perdre dans, to lose oneself in, s'enlisant, this is sort of like be buried in. Even agricultural terms, sombrer la terre is to give the earth its first labors, to sow the earth. So alongside sombre and sombrer, dark or darkening, Okar stresses the second personal indicative present of être, the es. So this horizontal ocular stretch in the third line, the white space that separates the letters E and S from one another, the white straight between the letterist parentheses. At its most extreme, the verb être is reduced to the unsounded closing S that you have at the very, very bottom. This S, which is historically elided in the form of a circumflex accent from the Middle French, estre. An ultimate stroke of sense effacement, Ockhard provocatively writes in Théorie des tables, une robe est rouge, which Michael Palmer translates as a dress are red. I have no conclusion. Where is I at the end of all of this? Having just flown in from France, I am jet lagged and I am at sea.